singing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. May God add his blessing to the reading of the lesson for his most holy word. And now our hymn of preparation, found in your hymnal on page 365, Grace Greater Than Our Sin. We will sing verses 1 and 2 as we remain seated. There are some requests and prayers that are in your bulletin, but we always have something come up. And so I invite you to have one that you want to lift for the congregation, you would do so at this time. Anybody?
We can't forget our military, our veterans, our first responders, and their families.
Amen.
Lynn Peck.
Amen. Others?
My papi said he could start walking because he's having a hard time to walk. And I pray for you and then Ms. Teresa and everyone up there that's seen me.
Thank you. Any others? As we pray today, I come in every Sunday morning. I come in fairly early. I have an opportunity to pray for you, the opportunity to pray with space both here and in Fellowship Hall. And I realize, you know, we all come in with things on our minds. I come in every morning, and when I get to the church, I drink a cup of coffee and a little bit of the news. And I am. Many years ago, in 2009, I did a funeral for a military person who was killed in Afghanistan. And I came in this morning and saw the news of all this going on in Afghanistan, and I wondered, you know, what would his family be praying today? And what it really dawned on me was not only what would they be praying, but what's God's will in this circumstance? Two friends of ours, both clergy, were diagnosed with COVID this week. One is out of the hospital and doing okay. The other is on a ventilator this morning. He has three boys. And I wondered, what's his family praying today? What's God doing? What's God's will in that circumstance? My niece, 6 months pregnant, on Friday, she failed at work on her stomach, began to bleed. She's doing okay, but she'll go to the doctor tomorrow, unsure of what is going on in life for baby. And so I wonder what my brother and his wife were praying today. And this God's will. I invite you as we pray today, we've lifted up names, we've lifted up concerns. Those are some that are hitting my heart, and you all have your own. And our prayer can always be like, I'm really good about telling God what to do. I've always been. But it really hit me this morning in my early prayer time. Maybe we stop telling God what to do, and we allow God to do His will. Because I know that some of who I would bring to you would pray for healing. And maybe what they need is God's mercy. That's a hard prayer to pray. Maybe some need strength. And maybe what God is doing is something different. So I just invite you, as we have an opportunity to pray together this morning, that we pray for God's will. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Almighty God, we come in this moment collected as a group. All of us, every single one of us, walked into this door, into this space, with things heavy on our hearts. So God, we just simply pray this moment for you to work, to move, to make your presence known. Help those who simply need to be reminded that you are God who is ahead of them, present in their life. Help them to feel that nudge by you. For those who need you to wrap their arms around them and not let them go,
So if you have your Bibles with you today, we'll turn to the fifth chapter of Romans. If Leviticus is everybody's favorite Old Testament, Romans has to be your favorite New Testament book of the Bible. Romans chapter 5, if you're using the Pew Bibles, it's on page 143 in the New Testament. And we're going to be looking at verses 6 through 9. Romans 5, verses 6 through 9. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. Amen. Almighty God, Lord, we come thankful that we're able to gather in this place and open up your word that your Holy Spirit still speaks. We pray, God, that as we spend a few moments together, we pray that we listen to you. May everything that I say come from you. And if I get in the way, get around me. We pray, God, that you move in us so that we're able to experience more of you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In the early church, they were very concerned with how to share the message. How to go out and share with people how to love God and how to grow in their faith. And in a way, they did it in a very practical way. I would say that one of the ways that they focused on in the early church was what we would call disciplined Christian living. It's one of the things I really appreciated about John Wesley as I studied him. He called it practical theology, practical divinity in the sense that we didn't just come, and I hope you know this, we did not come today to church to simply learn about God. I hope you realize that we didn't come in this space just to open up the Bible and study something and say, okay, that sounds good. We came into this space to learn, to study, to grow together, but so that we could go out into the world and that we could share that with other people. So I want you to be able to go where your workplaces are or go to your circles that you meet with into the schools, if you go into the schools at all, but you go into these places and you share the kingdom of God with these people. That's one of the reasons that we are here. And Wesley emphasized this Christian living. He also had an emphasis for the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Wesley believed at the same time as many others in his day that salvation came through grace. And he found a way to write about it and study it in a way that combined Christian living along with the saving grace of Christ. And so grace is central to our faith and how we understand God and how we live it out in the world around us. Now, many of you, if you've grown up in church, if I were to ask you your definition of grace, you're going to say back to me something like this, that it's the unmerited favor of God. That's the church language we use, and it's the appropriate definition. I want to read to you just a different definition of grace. It's the love and mercy of God that has been given to us because God wants us to have it, not because of anything we deserve or earn. Again, listen to that again. God, grace to be divine, is love and mercy of God that has been given to us simply because God wants us to have it, not because of anything we have earned or that we deserve to do. In Ephesians chapter 2, we read these words. In verses 8 and 9, it says, "For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." The incredible grace of God, the amazing grace of God, flows from God to us because of God's love for us. And so as we just started last week, if you're with us, was grace. Wesley understood grace as kind of a threefold process. You had prevenient grace, you have justifying grace, and sanctifying grace. All those are theological terms. us to be able to go out and say to someone, sanctifying grace, justifying grace, and believing grace, but it is important for us to understand what they want. And so as I studied Wesley's theology, Wesley had an image for grace that he used that I found very helpful when I was in seminary, and I hope that it's helpful for you to kind of get a better feel for how you understand and are able to articulate the concept of grace. And it's the image of a house. So last week we talked about the prevenient grace of God, and if you remember, we had a rocking chair down here on the front, and there was a welcome mat, and I shared with you that the prevenient grace of God, Wesley understood, is the front porch. So the front porch of the house of God. Next week, we're going to talk about the sanctifying grace of God, and the images, the interior rooms, all the interior rooms of your house, and you think about those as the sanctifying grace of God. Again, we'll talk about those next week. Today, I just want us to focus on this. What's this?
Door.
Front door. Now, we put the wreath so that you would know that it was the front door. It's not an interior door, it's the front door. And Wesley understood the front door as being justifying grace. And so we have prevenient, justifying, and sanctifying. Now, the prevenient grace of God is this grace of God that goes before us. So our ability to even know and be aware of God comes through the prevenient grace of God. Jesus tells us that he comes so that we can have a life of abundance, a life to the full. Us to even desire to want to have a life of abundance, for us to even desire to want that to be a part of who we are, that comes through the prevenient grace of God. God's prevenient grace, as I shared with you last week, God's prevenient grace is given to every man, woman, and child on this earth. And that's the prevenient grace of God. God takes the initiative. We don't have to beg for it. We don't have to plead for it. God wants us to have it. And that's the songs that we sing. And for us to even have our eyes open, for us to become aware that we're blind, comes through the prevenient grace of God. Now, Clay and I have, we got married when we were both 23 years old. And we decided fairly early that we were going to want to have children. And so we decided that once we had children, we wanted to be in church. A lot of people at that age, that's kind of when people, some people begin to think about church. And so that may be your story too. We decided, you know, we wanted our kids to be raised in church. I shared with you last week that I didn't grow up in the United Methodist Church. And so it really did not make a difference to me what denomination we went to. Claire, on the other hand, had been in the United Methodist her whole life, and so it was important for her that we stay within the United Methodist denomination. And so we started going to church. Probably it was about 25 years old when we went to United Methodist Church, and it was the first time in my life that I had ever heard that God loved me. 25 years old. It was the first time I'd ever heard really a theology of love and grace. I want that to set in with you for just a moment. You see, I grew up with an entirely different theology of God. I didn't know it. I couldn't probably name what it was, but I knew it was different. When I went into the United Methodist Church and I heard about a God who loved me and a God who wants the best for me, I felt the presence and power of God in my life probably for the very first time. In a very powerful, tangible way. So for those of you who grew up in the United Methodist Church, you may not be familiar with that. And so I want to read to you an excerpt from the sermon. This is not a sermon that I wrote. It's not a sermon that I've ever listened to because it was written in the 1700s. But it gives a really good kind of image of the theology that I'm talking about. And so it's from a sermon called Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. Some of you have also had that theology. Listen to this. It says, "The God that holds you over the pit of hell, much as one holds a spider or some loathsome insect over the fire, abhors you and is dreadfully provoked. His wrath towards you burns like fire. He looks upon you as worthy of nothing else but to be cast into the fire. He is of purer eyes than to bear to have you in his sight. You are 10,000 more times abominable in his eyes than the most hateful venomous serpent is in ours. Now, I don't know about you, but when I hear that read and it takes me back, I am incredibly thankful for the amazing grace of Jesus Christ. I'm incredibly thankful for a theology of grace and mercy. Because when you hear that, you can hopefully see how that kind of theology can lock you in to the fact that you can never do anything good. There's nothing, and God is waiting. He's just waiting for you to make a mistake, and he's going to pounce on you. That's the theology that I grew up with, this theology of discernment. So when I walked into the United States Church, it was something totally different for me. Now here's the problem, though, is so many times we resist that theology that we sometimes forget our own theology. And here's how I know that it's true. I can stand up here and preach to you about the prevenient grace of God. I can tell you that God's prevenient grace is given to every man, woman, and child, that God loves you, and that God has given this grace to you. We don't have to do anything to deserve it. And here's what you're going to do. You're going to nod your head. You're going to smile. You're going to affirm it as best you can in your body language. But you might, if you get really crazy, you might say yes. And I could make an amen out of you. But you want to hear about the prevenient grace of God. Next week, I'm going to preach to you about the sanctifying grace of God, and you're going to hear that God wants to restore you, and God wants the most for you, and that God is going to encourage you and strengthen you and embolden you, and God is going to do all of this so that you can become the person that God created you to be, and you are going to be like, yes, that is what I want. I want that God. I love that God. I want to hear more sermons about that. Prevenient grace and just and sanctifying grace. And here's the problem, is we want to move from prevenient grace to sanctifying grace. We want to move one to the other without ever really talking about the front door. It's like going from Christmas morning to the empty tomb. You're going to hear me say this every Easter. I cannot imagine how you go from Christmas morning to the empty tomb and really celebrate Easter the way that you should be celebrating Easter as people of God. Because here's what I want you to think about. Christmas morning. Man, or Christmas Eve is when we celebrate. Christmas Eve, man, it's exciting, right? I mean, it's beautiful. The decorations are great. Everybody's excited about what tomorrow is going to bring. We are we love the image of God coming to us in the form of a baby. All of this is great for us. Easter morning, empty tomb, miracle. We all want to know that God is in the business of doing miracles. But what do we miss from Christmas morning to the empty tomb? What do you think we miss? It's a question. The cross. We miss everything. Think about it liturgically. First, Ash Wednesday. Favorite service of the year. I love Ash Wednesday. We miss Ash Wednesday. This time where we're reflecting about the sin that we, in our mortality. We miss Maundy Thursday. We miss Good Friday. We miss the cross. We miss the sacrifice and the suffering. If we jump from Christmas morning to the empty tomb, we miss all of this part that is integral to our story. On the cross, what is it that Jesus looks at the crowd and prays? Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. Well, who's he saving? Who's he forgiving? Is he forgiving the people that are nailing him to the cross? Is he forgiving the people that are walking by on the street and looking at him and spitting at him or mocking him? Are we a part of the them that he forgives? Listen to what it says in Romans chapter 3. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fallen. redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as the sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his righteousness, and at the present time, so as to be just, and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. So Paul writes this to the church in Rome. Is he wrong? Is he wrong that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God? Is he wrong in the book of Ephesians when he says that we are dead in trespasses? I want you to realize that there's truth to what Paul says. That we are part of the them he forgives. And we have to deal with that part of us that is dead. We have to deal with that part of our life. We have to come to a place where we realize we are not who we ought to be, and that we can't do anything about becoming who the people are that we ought to be on our own, by ourselves. And we don't have to go down the road of sinners in the hands of an angry God to get there. But I do want you to realize we do have to deal with the fact that we have to be forgiven. That we have need for forgiveness, that we need God. And regardless of whether you like it or not, it is thoroughly a part of our heritage and our history as people who follow the line of the Wesleyan way of thinking. We have to go through the front door. Every one of us. We have to go through the front door. Wesley described the justification in a very simple way in a sermon he wrote called Christian Perfection. He says this: the plain scriptural notion of justification is part of the forgiveness of sins. We hear that and we kind of just assume we know what it means, but we got to realize that Wesley was at a time where people were teaching something different. They were teaching that justification, justifying, being made not guilty by God, that you became justified when you were purified, when you were holy, when you were sanctified, then you were made justified. And Wesley looks at Scripture and goes, no, wait a minute. It's not when you're holy do you become justified. It's not when you are sanctified do you become holy. He was completely countercultural. Listen to what he says. He asked this question in one of his writings. Who are they that are justified? The ungodly. For it is not a saint but a sinner that is forgiven. God justifies not the godly, but the ungodly. Not those who are holy already, but the unholy. Does the good shepherd seek and save only those that are lost already? No. He seeks and saves that which is lost. He pardons those who need his pardoning mercy. Next week, we're going to talk about sanctifying grace, and the goal of sanctifying grace is what God does in us. But what I want you to realize, in justifying grace, it's about what God has done for us. Not what God does in us, but what God does for us. It's part of the process. Listen again to the words that we started with in Romans 5. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? If you have grown up in this church, you probably have heard the communion liturgy. You probably know it better than I know it. And I hope that you recognize part of that scripture in what we say when we celebrate communion. Hear the good news, church. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That proves God's love towards us. You may not like dealing with these terms, but we have to come to a realization and recognize that every single one of us have to enter through the front door. We have to come to a place where we know that we need God, that we need forgiveness, that we need and stand in the need of the amazing grace of Jesus Christ. And here's the truth. We want it for ourselves, but we don't always want to share it with other people. We want to be forgiven, but we don't want to have to forgive others. We want grace. We don't want to extend grace. Mr. Jackson, we are trying an experiment in our house. If you work for the cable company, I apologize. We are trying to cut the cord on cable. And so we are trying to watch TV through apps. And so it creates for us some strange TV viewing. We watch some shows that we probably never would have watched before. Just the other night, we found ourselves watching a TV show called Van Gogh. I don't know if you've ever seen it. It's about a guy who lives in a van. And he has decided that a lot of us need to live in vans. And so he is taking your van and will like recreate it into a home. So like, he literally puts walls and stuff inside the van and creates these rooms for you to be able to live into. I'm going to tell you that just so y'all kind of know how bad we are and what we're watching. Because we watched 3 episodes of that. But we watched a show. This was Roger Cat. We watched a show called The Making of a Killer. And it's, again, probably not a show you should watch, but it follows a person who killed someone, and you kind of get to see some of the psychiatry of that person. And so one of the episodes was this young lady who met a gentleman, and within a few weeks, she killed him. And so you begin to meet her and hear a little bit of her story. Well, a few minutes into the episode, we met the parents of the young man that she killed. And it was the mother and the stepfather. And they began to write her letters. And as they wrote letters, she began to write letters back. And for us, when we watched this, the story shifted from the young girl to this mother and stepdad who lost their son, because they began to go and visit her, and they began to engage her, and they eventually met with her and began to share with her how much they forgave her. And now they go all over the country and they tell their story. And so many people are asking, like, how can you do that? And we watched the show, and we were thinking, I'd like to think that I have that kind of faith. But I don't know. Just being honest, you know, you don't know until you're in that situation. But I do know this, that it's impossible for them to be able to forgive without understanding what forgiveness is in their own life. It's impossible for them to be able to forgive without experiencing the forgiving grace of God in their own life. It was extremely powerful. But here's what I came and walked away with. Forgiveness comes at a cost, and that's true for grace. Grace, even though it is free, it comes at a cost to all of us. We have to let go of certain things, and we have to answer God and become the people that God wants us to be rather than the people that we want to be. And these are very complicated things, but yet in some ways they are very simple. All of us, every single person in this room, we have to come to a place where we recognize that we need God. That we need Jesus Christ. That our relationship cannot be restored because of anything we do, but only because of what God does. And it's a gift. And here's what I want you to understand. There is no, this gift is the front door. There's no hoop that you have to jump through. If somebody tells you that there's a particular prayer you have to pray to enter into the front door, there's not a particular prayer. It's a response. It's turning away from sin and turning towards God. It's accepting the grace that He has given me. I don't have to know what God's going to do in my life tomorrow, a week from now, a year from now. Just accept the grace that God has given me today. Jesus tells Nicodemus in Scripture that you have to be born anew. Justification is this moment that all of us, if we're going to follow Christ, it's this moment that we enter into this process of becoming who Christ created me to be. And it's a gift. And so I want you to think this morning. I want you to think about your own forgiveness. Last week I shared with you that one of my fears in ministry is that the church will hurt my children. So I'm going to share with you fear number two. Fear number two is that because of my experience growing up, with the theology that I grew up with. That I am going to spend all of my time preaching to you about believing grace. Or I'm going to spend a lot of my time preaching to you about sanctifying grace. And I forget to tell you about justifying grace. I'll spend time telling you that God loves you and that God wants to restore you, but I forget to remind you that we have to go in to the front door. To have the joy of Christ, to live life the full, the way that Christ wants you, you have to enter in to the front door. So I wanted you to have this image today, because here's what I know we can do in the church. I went around and tried to find, somebody asked me this morning if it was my front door, it's not my front door. We're okay, it's a house of sin. So we walked around this week. I was sure, and I'm sure some of the trustees are fixing to go find and tell me where this, I was sure there was a closet where all the doors are that we have kept over the years, but I could not find that. So we started looking around, and went into the offices, and thought, okay, I'm going to take one of the office doors. And this was the only one that wasn't painted shut to where we can take it off. Y'all should have seen me and Sonia carrying it from the office over to the
goodness.
But I love this image because it had panes in it, has window panes. And here's why. Because here's what we can be very comfortable doing in the church. The window panes allow us to see inside. And so we can stand on the front porch. And we can see inside. And we can think everything's okay. We know the right words to say. We serve on committees. We go to Sunday school every week. But the reality is, if we really stop and think about our lives, we realize we've never gone through the front door. And I do not, on my watch, want to not give you the opportunity to go through the front door. I may not do it every week. Somebody asked me last week, was it okay to come to the altar? Let me tell you something. It is always okay for you to come to the altar. I don't care if Michael's doing the greeting and you feel led to come to the altar, you come on down to the altar. The altar is always open in the church. So I'm going to invite you to do something that maybe we don't do that often. I don't know. I don't have been around Jackson to know enough yet. But I want to invite you to bow your heads, close your eyes. If you feel led as I pray and you want to come to the altar, feel free to do that. I know we're always so nervous about what somebody else is going to think. Don't look to the window pane. This is an opportunity for somebody who's feeling the nudge of the Holy Spirit to come through the front door. And so I just want us to spend a moment. God's tugging your heart for you to be able to respond. And so I'm just going to lift up a prayer, and I'm going to invite you to bow your heads, close your eyes as we spend a moment in confession. Would you pray with me? Hear our prayer, God. We confess to you, all-knowing God, what we are. Lord, we are not the people that we want people to think we are. We are afraid to admit even to ourselves what lies in the depths of our soul. We cannot hide our true selves from you. You know us for what we are. And yet you love us. Help us not, O God, to shrink from self-knowledge. Teach us to respect ourselves, but to give you the glory for it. Give us a call to courage to put our trust in your power and in your presence and in your healing. Raise us out of the paralysis of guilt into freedom. Give us the energy as forgiven people. And God, if there's anyone in this room who through long habit has become hardened in their heart, help them find freedom. Help them be set free. May they lean into Jesus Christ. May they see Christ as their Redeemer. Lord, help us to say yes in this moment because you are a God who has said yes to us. It's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. And I want to invite you this morning, if you can pray that as part of your prayer. Any part. Remember I told you there's no hoops. But if you felt a nudge by God, I want you to hear something extremely important. Maybe the best news you will ever hear in your entire life. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray one more time as we get ready to sing our closing hymn. Most gracious God, we thank you that you are a God of grace, that you are a God who is ahead of us, that you are a God who continues to restore us. But now in this moment, God, we thank you that you are a God who justifies us. I pray, Lord, for each of us